start by introducing myself. Thank you so much for the invitation, Ron. It's I really admire the work of the ISBS, and it's a great opportunity here to share some of the work I've been doing here in London. So, my name's Charlie Harriet Maitland. I'm a clinical psychologist, also a researcher at King's College London, and I'm a trainer. All the work I'm doing now, therapy, research, and training is all CFT, compassion focused therapy for psychosis. So it's pretty much taken over everything now. And yeah, I just wanted to use this time today to share some of the developments, some of the science that's been informing this work. Some of the techniques that we've been trying to develop, applying compassion-focused therapy for voice hearers. But I guess, before getting into all that, I guess I wanted to start with quite a heartfelt point, really, is that I personally have a lot of trust in the brain's natural healing, adapting, problem-solving processes. I really think that the mind, the brain, has a capacity to adapt to its conditions. And in the same way that a brain will adapt to threatening conditions, terrifying conditions, adverse conditions, by doing things like dissociating and protecting itself, I also think the brain will adapt to conditions of compassion and caring, safeness. So I think our job as the people who want to help people with voice hearing experiences, or who want to help ourselves if we are experiencing voices, actually, our job is not so much to develop a load of fancy techniques to come in and fix or change these voices. It's actually a lot simpler than that, I believe, our job. Our job's more to create context in which people can start using their own problem-solving, natural healing processes. So sometimes all these techniques and fancy new developments and technology take attention away from, the really important stuff, which is, human connection and warmth and safeness. And actually, if a brain, an evolved brain, is operating in those conditions, then I think it will find a way through some of these problems, or at least feel safe enough to start exploring and trying to make sense and trying to find the way forward. So I guess the model is based on compassion-focused therapy, but compassion-focused therapy isn't a specific separate school of therapy different to anything else. It's more a framework for organizing different interventions. So we're really, really process orientated in compassion focused therapy. It's more about the emotion systems we're trying to stimulate, the contexts that we're trying to cultivate so that brains can do their own problem solving. So I've got a few slides, so I might just put up these slides now, if that's okay. So just want to acknowledge some really important people here with this work. Dr. Chris Irons, who's a colleague of mine at Balanced Minds in London. He's very heavily involved with the Compassion Focused Therapy, the Compassionate Mind Foundation, as of course is Paul Gilbert, who's the founder. And I've been really lucky to work with these two very compassionate guys in the UK. Very wise, very well read, very scientific, and wonderful insight into how to help human beings with evolved, tricky brains. And of course, Dr. Eleanor Longden, who has been a wonderful co-worker and colleague and an inspiration for a lot of this approach. And I've been really lucky to be sharing a lot of platforms with Eleanor. We run our workshops together usually now as co-facilitators, and we've got a load more of them coming up in 2017. Drawing from Eleanor's lived experience of hearing voices and combining that with Paul Gilbert's real wisdom and insight and vast knowledge of science, bringing those two strands together has really created the context for developing this approach. So just want to acknowledge their contributions first. So for this hour or so, hour and a half, just want to start by inviting everyone to temporarily step out of our traditional approaches and to take a really broad, fresh look at psychosis. So I'm going to invite you to take a look at normal evolved brains operating in difficult conditions, rather than the kind of stuff that we are traditionally more used to, which is abnormal brains or brains that have developed diseases or problems. So we're just trying to sort of take a broader look and trying to come at this approach from a premise of normality. And also come at this from a scientific understanding of the brain and the mind, rather than a scientific approach to treatment. So this whole thing that we'll be talking about today, this whole approach, will be guided by a much broader science, not the kind of narrow science that unfortunately has quite limited our knowledge and our therapies and our interventions, because it's focused a lot on treatment and assuming that something's wrong that needs fixing. So we're just going to temporarily suspend our traditional approaches and for this hour and a half, just open our minds a bit more to slightly different ideas or slightly different angles coming into this. And the objective mainly is to understand the roles of safeness and compassion in providing the foundations and framework and key processes from which we can then start to develop the courage and confidence to work with distress. So I just want to say a little bit more about what I meant by this whole difference between the two versions of science, because it might be a little bit complicated. So I've got a slide on this. So the science of treatment is focused in finding the best methods of treating and improving our understanding of what goes wrong. And it's very different to what we're going to come at today, the angle we're going to come at today, which is the science of the mind. So we're not being unscientific here, we're just opening our science, the doors of science, a bit more broadly. So we're trying to improve our understanding of how the brain has evolved to function in different environments. Science of treatment stems from the premise of pathology, that there must be something wrong that we have to fix. Whereas the science of the mind-brain just stems from this premise of normality. We have human brains, and they are pretty tricky, actually. They're, to be honest, they're pretty capable of some pretty tricky things, some pretty awful things, some pretty scary things, as we're seeing right now in the world, actually. You know, the human brain is quite tricky, but it is still the human brain. We're starting from the premise of the evolved brain that's capable of having different kinds of experiences in the right environment context. The kind of science that we are wrapping this up in really, really organizes the type of research questions we ask. So, science of treatment asks things like, what has gone wrong? How can we spot that? Who's more vulnerable? What are the risk factors? You know, these are all the really familiar questions that we've been used to for the last 100 years trying to research psychosis and voice hearing. These are the questions that we've been asking. And in terms of interventions, what are the best interventions to target these things that go wrong and their associated risk factors? Now, if we look at if we step back and look more broadly at the science of the mind, the research questions we are now asking, or I believe we should be asking more, are what experiences have occurred? And as a result of these experiences, which brain systems have been activated and which have become more sensitized over time? How has the brain become shaped? How has the mind, how has thinking become shaped as a result of these experiences? How have people's minds and brains reacted emotionally to these experiences? And as a result of these experiences, which systems haven't been activated? And so therefore the question about treatment or interventions, in fact, I don't really like either of those words, maybe facilitation, is what new experiences can we build to help the brain function in a way that allows it to flourish? You know, what experiences can we create around a person that will help their brain, their mind, start functioning in a way that helps them to start moving forward? So it's, I mean, it might be, some of you might think this is, you know, quite subtle differences, but when you start kind of developing a whole science around these things, they're massive differences. One is much more outcome-led. Treatment outcomes are the only important thing that guide science of treatment. Whereas the science of the brain, we're much more interested in understanding process. And of course, it's important eventually to get around to evaluating outcome of our treatments, but we need period of really trying to understand brains and how they're operating in different conditions and what conditions we can create to allow brains to flourish again. So I'm gonna play this video, which is a 5-minute video, and this is going to really start us off in shaping the rest of the time talking to you. So I'll show you the video and then I'll pick it apart bit by bit. And with each section of the video, I'll talk a bit about the science that's informed this bit of the video and give an idea of some of the interventions, some of the facilitation work that we can do as individuals, as communities, as families, as therapists, to help work with some of these distressing experiences. So this is a video, 5 minutes, about a young guy, Stuart, who's a guy that I actually worked with in London. And it shows him going through the journey, really, of being tormented by his voices. And we can see him going through daily life. We can see how his social environment affects his voice hearing experiences and his emotion systems. So we can see these three things interacting: emotion, environment, voices. Emotion, environment, voices. So we, you know, the idea of this video is to show how these three things are interacting as he goes through his daily life. And then we see him coming to talk to someone who helps him start to feel more safe, starting more physiologically, starting with the body. So then he comes in to speak to someone in therapy and starts the process of starting to feel safe, both interpersonally in a relationship with the therapist, but also more physiologically by practicing exercises, breathing, and imagery. And then he starts to the strength and courage from this feeling of safeness. That's really the foundation here, starting to feel safe. And it's from that safe base that you can start to develop confidence and courage to start exploring his experiences. So in this case, he starts developing a compassionate conversation with his most critical voice. So I'll show you the video now, and then we'll talk about it a bit after that.
This is a film about Stuart. Stuart and his voices.
You can't do
football
it
today.
Brush your teeth.
No way.
Football. Get up. Useless.
These circles represent our three major emotion systems and how they are balanced. The threat system kicks in.
They're coming for you. They've set you up. They know what you've done. They'll lock you up and never let you out. You might as well give up now. This is too much. It's all too much. Pathetic.
Stuart's drive system comes online.
Come on. Come on, Stuart. They don't want you in the team. Miss. Go on, miss.
Stuart is starting a therapy to help him cultivate compassion for himself, his feelings, and his voices.
Weak. You're weak for seeking therapy. You're weak. Be a man. Walk away. Don't trust her.
Over time, Stuart's therapist gradually helps him to feel more safe. They practice exercises that help him feel more grounded and still. Slowing down his body using breathing and imagery, activating his soothing system. Stuart develops an image of an ideal, compassionate person, focusing on each of its compassionate qualities. He tries to imagine what it would be like to step into this image and become this compassionate person. He walks around, acting the part of his compassionate self, getting a sense of what that would feel like, how he would think, what he would do. He practices at home as well, and gradually begins to deepen his understanding and sense of his compassionate self. As Stuart feels safer, stronger, and more courageous, he decides to start a conversation from his compassionate self to his most critical voice.
Hello. What do you want, loser? I want to understand you. I want to help you feel safe. Safe? Nothing's safe around here. If it wasn't for me, you'd be... I know you're trying to help me. Thank you. Thank you for reminding me that I get scared. You're right, I do. But I want to start overcoming my fears now. I'm ready. You want to get rid of me? No, I don't. I don't want to get rid of anyone. We can work on this together.
Hearing voices is a common human experience. It can often be linked to something difficult or painful that's happened in the past. Although tricky at times, with lots of practice and encouragement, Stuart's compassionate self becomes better developed.
Danger! Back to bed. You're not ready. It's okay, guys. Thanks for the warning. I'll keep an eye out, but there's things I need to do today. Hey, it's all right. We can manage this. We'll see. Hey!
Stuart now feels safe in relation to his voices. He understands and accepts them. They're very much part of the family, but no longer running the show. With his compassionate self in the driving seat, Stuart can now follow his true desires.
So as we can see in this video, there's a really important preparation period for Stuart. He doesn't just kind of go headlong into trying to talk to his voices, because actually that's really, really hard for a lot of people. You know, that's really distressing and scary, and actually some people would think that was just totally reckless. So what's really crucial is that Stuart is going through a series of practices which is essentially about like training. You know, it's a bit like if you're gonna climb Mount Everest or run a marathon, you would probably do a bit of training beforehand. So Stuart's training in this case is trying to develop an internal secure base, essentially an internal foundation of strength and safeness and wisdom. And with that, crucially, is a motivation for caring. Motivation for compassion. And it's only when he feels ready with those skills, with those qualities, with those motivations, with that internal sense of safeness, that's the point that he can start actually having quite a meaningful relationship with the voice, to try and really understand it, to try and really in his case, it wouldn't be the same for everyone, but in his case, to really try and develop an alliance with the voice. And this in compassion focused therapy, you know, we really try and do whatever we can in the therapy, but also working with people's relationships and social context. The interpersonal safeness is so crucial to develop that internal sense of safeness. You know, it's got to be in externally and internally, really. That's where you feel most safe. So in the therapy, we're really trying to work with networks and family to create a safe context interpersonally, and developing a load of practices to do this internally as well. So I'm just gonna go through the video bit by bit with a few slides now. So we start off here with the three circles. And for those of you who don't know, just very quickly talk about what this means. So Essentially, there's three major emotion systems which have evolved for different reasons. The threat and self-protection system has really evolved to keep us safe. Its job is to detect threats in the environment and to respond in a way that will enhance our survival. So the kind of emotions that direct this system and get stimulated in the system are anger, anxiety, and disgust. So, I mean, this is a simplified model, the three circles model that Paul Gilbert has adapted from essentially what the neuroscientific research is saying from brain scans, that emotion systems are organized into these three major clusters. It's a bit more complicated than that, obviously, but for clinical purposes, for helping people understand, this three circles model is a really helpful roadmap. So we have the threat emotions. We also have the drive system, which is was evolved over many millions of years to encourage us to seek out resources, to seek out food and relationships, to acquire things and to feel good when we acquire things. So that reinforces our behavior. So we get an excitement in our body, pleasure, which reinforces this drive. So it's more of a positive emotion system, more fuzzy sort of positive emotion. And then finally, the soothing system, which again is a positive emotion system, but very different types of positive emotion. It's much more feelings of contentment, safeness, and connection, where we don't need to acquire anything, and also we don't need to keep ourselves safe from danger. We can just feel close, connected, and peaceful within our affiliative relationships. And this system is really important, as we saw in the diagram and in the video. So we go through each of these systems just to kind of map it out in the video. We don't have very long in the video, it's 5 minutes. There's a lot of stuff that we cover. So we see Stuart in his threat system there, drive system, and soothing system there. Now, the threat system is really important in mental health across the board. We can pretty confidently say that most, if not all, mental health symptoms or diagnosis can be seen as some kind of strategy to manage the threat system. So whether it's a kind of OCD type, checking behavior or obsessive thinking as a way to manage anxiety, or in psychosis, what we're talking about today, whether a mind dissociates as a form of threat protection, we can really see the importance of the threat system when trying to understand mental health symptoms and experiences. And actually, it's no coincidence, of course, that most of the people who come in to mental health services have reported quite difficult experiences. Some of these are experiences of external threat, things like bullying or abuse or trauma, but also high levels of internal threat as well. So these are the more how we relate to ourselves. And a lot of people coming into mental health services have high levels of shame and quite self-criticizing, self-disliking, even self-hating relationships. So threat is something that seems to be activated quite highly across the board in the work that I do as a clinical psychologist, and any other sort of therapy mental health settings. The other thing is that quite often people report quite few experiences of feeling safe, quite a lack of this kind of experience. So what we get is this kind of, quite often, is this kind of combination of the two, like a highly sensitive threat system, but also quite an underdeveloped soothing system, which is the green system. So it's kind of this combination of the two. And of course, without much of a soothing system to draw on, it's hard to regulate, it's hard to calm down the threat system. So the threat system can pretty much run wild and process the world through that lens of danger and threat. And you know, it's not that people with mental health problems don't have a soothing system, or they're born with an enormous threat system. These are things that have developed through experiences and over time. You know, it may be that there haven't been as many opportunities to develop a soothing system, or to develop an internal calming resource or self-reassurance. That doesn't mean that we can't start developing these experiences. You know, it's a bit like going to the gym and your muscles in the body. You know, the muscles are there, and if you started going to the gym, they might start growing. I haven't done that yet, but I people tell me that's what happens. You know, the muscles will start growing. You know, we can start cultivating our soothing system. We've got the hardwiring for it, and it's a wonderful internally built threat regulator. And a lot of this approach, as we saw in the video with Stuart, a lot of this approach starts with trying to build up the soothing system as a way of regulating the threat system and starting to develop that internal sense of safeness and groundedness that will allow us to start exploring our voices, our fears, our traumas, all the things in the threat system that are really, really hard to explore. We'll start developing that internal resource to be able to do that. So the threat system is really important in psychosis. A lot of the research shows that voices, well, I mean, we don't need research. We just need to listen to people, really. You know, voices are often making explicit threats. Feelings of being watched, conspiracies, you know, these are very threat-based experiences that people with psychosis are having. And the research also shows that there are a lot of threat biases in how information is processed in psychosis populations compared to other populations. Normal population or non-clinical population. So for instance, people with psychosis pay biased attention to threat stimuli and also have biased memory of threat relevant information. So, you know, so it's, you know, this is stuff we know from the research that actually people's threat systems are quite sensitized. You know, a bit like in that, you can see on the slide, the top left, there's Stuart standing in the mirror with a big red circle on his chest and a tiny little blue and a tiny little green. You know, that's what the experience is like. Threat system is dominating a lot of how the world is processed. And of course, this is totally understandable. This is totally understandable because when you've been through difficult experiences in your life, of course the threat system has to be used over and over again. That's survival. That's the brain adapting to its environment. It's your brain working perfectly. Of course the threat system has had to be drawn on again and again and again to just deal with getting through life, whether it's bullying, trauma, whether it's an abusive household. Of course the threat system is going to be exercised more than any other system. And the more that the threat system gets activated over the course of a life, and particularly if it's repeated over and over again, then the threat system becomes more sensitized over time. So now it, you know, what you get later on in life is you don't actually need much of a trigger for it to jump into action, because it's already the dominant system, you know, it's sensitized, it's ready to pounce on everything, even if it's ambiguous. So it's a very different understanding of these experiences based on normal brains, like that slide I showed you right at the beginning, normal evolved brains operating in their environment. And if we started to see these experiences in these terms, then that really shines a light on what we can do about this. We've got to create new environments. We've got to create environments in which people can feel safe and calm and cared for. So we'll come on to that. The other crucial thing to say about the threat system in psychosis is, you know, that it's all escalated, how the threat system works, by the social position that someone with psychosis find themselves in. So as if it wasn't problematic enough having a hypersensitive threat system, someone with psychosis then faces the additional layer of threat linked to their social rank, social position. Things like stigma, feeling low down the social order. And of course, these kind of social experiences lead to developing a negative internal relationship with oneself. Some of the treatment approaches that we have historically, some of the contexts and services that we are working in, they have historically been designed to manage threat. So in a sense, they are kind of operating from their threat system as well, which isn't always how we want to rebalance emotions with more threat, you know, coming onto an inpatient unit with lots of alarms going off and aggression and anger, you know, this is not how we're going to create a context for a brain to recover. So this is really, really helpful stuff, thinking about the evolutionary basis, stripping this down to basic psychological and emotional processes. Okay, so we've talked a lot about the threat system. Now, I just want to say a bit about the soothing system as well. So it was John Bowlby, who was the psychologist, British psychologist, who developed attachment theory. And basically, he observed loads of parents and children. And yeah, he saw that actually there are built-in mechanisms, evolved mechanisms when we're born that drive an infant to seek closeness, to seek attachment, and to feel safe when the parent is close. So essentially our brains are wired up to be calmed down in the face of loving, caring, and kindness. So when a mother soothes a baby, you know, with a soothing voice and touch, it's an inbuilt calming process gets activated. The baby's distress lessens within that affiliative bond, within that attachment. So that loving, caring, kindness calms the threat system down from the day we're born. And the other important thing about attachment theory here, and that's relevant here, is actually that not only does the green system or the soothing system calm down the threat system through that attachment, that connection, with a close relationship. It also provides a secure base for the child to then go out and explore the world. So the attachment is also a provider of confidence for the child growing up to start going out and taking risks in the world, to start taking on challenges, you know, to start leaving the home and finding how to cope out in the world. So that attachment also is a source of strength and courage for the child to do difficult things, which again is important when we're applying this model in voice hearing psychosis. There are a few people who have been looking at the neurophysiology of safeness in the soothing system. One of the things that keeps cropping up is the role of oxytocin, which is thought to have a role in social affiliation experiences, but also this sort of threat calming responses. So trying to understand what is going on at the neurological level. And actually, again, it's helpful to think here about from in the evolutionary context. So this is some really interesting ideas from Stephen Porges. So basically, it makes a lot of sense why we would have had over evolutionary history developed neural circuits to detect if an environment is safe. So if we have like a caveman coming back from hunting and keep picking up some social signals from the rest of the tribe, things like smiling face, eye contact, relaxed facial muscles, then these signals would have implicitly signaled to the returning caveman that the environment's safe. You know, so facial muscles, eye contact, voice tone, all of these things will have been wired up together over many millions of years to tap the safeness system, the parasympathetic, you know, this environment is safe. So this is why in compassion-focused therapy, we use these things. We use facial muscles, smiling exercises, voice tone exercises, body posture exercises, because we think that all this stuff is wired up together with the green system. These are all ways that we can get direct experiences of safeness going, which is really, really crucial in knowing how to work with the threat system and work with psychosis. So there are three main stages in the video, and I'm going to go quite quickly through them because these are also the stages of the interventions that we've been trying to develop and research over here in the UK. Establishing safeness, I've talked a lot about that already. Step two, cultivating the compassionate self. And step three, once we've cultivated this inner safe base, this self-identity with the qualities that are required, then directing it to do the work that's needed in the therapy or in the relationship with one's fears or voices. So the step one, external and internal social safeness, you know, this is, there's a diagram there which shows how the soothing affiliative system has a calming effect on the threat system. So creating safe relationships around people, this is why I'm a massive supporter of open dialogue, which is, some of you will probably know this already. It's a sort of whole team and whole network approach to mental health treatment, where essentially a network of professionals and families, friends, consistently meet creating just that kind of sense of being held and feeling safe interpersonally with a consistent group, consistent network. And over time, the person is just allowed to start exploring ideas. So no one's reaching in trying to fix it. We're just creating safeness around the person for for their own exploration to start. So I think it's a very compatible approach with compassion-focused therapy, working more with the system rather than with an individual. Both of these are really important. And as we increase the experiences of social safeness and increase the green system, then we get this calming down of the threat system. And also, these states of calming down the threat system allow the brain to start functioning again, to start problem solving. Because when we're in our threat system, the kind of problem solving, the kind of planning, clever frontal lobe functioning of our brain gets short-circuited. The brain is only interested in our survival. There isn't time to do careful deliberation through things. And of course, we know, that's why people in their threat system will jump to conclusions and act on the principle of being better safe than sorry. So we need to calm the threat system down in order to get the brain functioning again and start problem solving for itself. It's just a summary of a few of the internal and external experiences and approaches and exercises that we might try and do. I'm going to focus more on the internal today, but just want to say at this point that the external, creating social safeness externally is absolutely crucial. And you'll have your own ideas, hopefully, of how you might try and help people with this. Linking them in with networks and peer support groups, and education and reconnecting with friends, families, those kind of things, if that's going to be helpful. So I'm going to focus on the internal stuff here. First of all, breathing practice. So there's a lot of research now showing how actual, just soothing breathing at a rate of around 4.5 to 6.5 breaths per minute can achieve this bodily physiology of calming down the threat system. So we're really activating the parasympathetic responses to stress. I'm gonna just carry on with the slides. I was gonna do a bit of a breathing exercise with you, but I think I'll just carry on with the slides. But if any of you have iPhones or if any of you have iPads, I'm not a shareholder, but there's a very good app called Breathing Zone, which I use a lot of the time, where you can, it's that thing shown there on the screen. And basically, you can set it to a rate of breathing around 6 breaths per minute, and that diagram goes in and out, and you breathe in time to the movement of the colors. And it's a really wonderful way. It's helped a lot of my clients, particularly ones who get quite anxious thinking about breathing and get quite panicky, to have like a visual cue that they can look at outside just to help calm down their breathing, getting it a bit slower, starting to activate that green parasympathetic system. Then, of course, we see Stuart in the video going through some imagery exercises. And again, there's a research that backs up why we use this kind of stuff in compassion-focused therapy. So there's research that says, that 4 weeks guided imagery can reduce salivary cortisol. So this is an indicator, a biomarker of threat responses. And similarly with compassionate imagery, there's quite a lot of research now showing the sort of with biomarkers showing the positive effects of imagining compassionate images, compassionate relationships, and the effect that has on the immune system and the stress system as well. So we've got evidence that we can really calm the threat system down using imagery practices. This is why we show Stuart doing this in the video. We also show Stuart doing some facial expression practice, voice tones, and body posture. And again, all of these elements of the film, they've gone into the film because they're all evidence-based. There's some experiments showing that with facial expression, manipulating facial expression, in one group they had they asked the participants to hold a chopstick in their mouth this way, and in the other group they asked them to hold the chopstick in their mouth this way, and they tested the two conditions, giving them a stress task, and they found that the people holding the chopstick in their mouth this way had lower heart rates during stress recovery. So a very simple change of facial muscle was able to have a regulatory effect on the threat system. So we use this in therapy. It's a nice direct route in to the kind of emotions we're trying to stimulate. Similarly with voice tones and body posture, there's a lot of research looking at how these can also have an impact on stimulating soothing emotions, stimulating oxytocin, and regulating threat. So we use them in the therapy as well. It's quite a physical, experiential therapy where we get people walking around, like you see Stuart do in the video. Cultivating the compassionate self. This is essentially a self-identity that holds everything together. It organizes our mind. It's a part of us that has the qualities that we need to do to come face to face with our fears and our pain. So some of the important things to do that will be things like strength. For Stuart, courage was a really important quality for him to cultivate. So our training period, cultivating the compassionate self, really focused on cultivating that sense of courage and strength that he can actually stand firm in the face of the sort of barrage of hostility coming from the voice. So for Stuart, this was a really important quality. But everyone will have their own version of this. Every individual, every client. For some people, maybe wisdom will be more important. Some mixture of empathy, non-judgment. So we'll be working with our clients about what's important to them. What does your compassionate self need in order to do the required work, i.e. going into the threat system and processing and uprooting some of that suffering. So compassionate self is an identity that holds the various practices and qualities and skills and postures and voice tones together. It's something that they can develop as a character in the therapy, which helps glue all these practices and skills together. And then the crucial thing is just the homework. Week in, week out, practicing embodying the compassionate self, getting a felt sense of what that feels like to have that sense of security, that inner strength. How would the compassionate self think in this situation? How would I look out at the world through that lens of the compassionate self? It takes a lot of practice. It's like again the gym analogy. If you want to make some difference to your body shape, then you're going to have to keep going to the gym quite regularly every week. You know, it's the same with minds. It's the same with emotions. We need that commitment to practicing, to really stimulate this part of us, this resilience, really, that's going to allow us to go into a difficult conversation with our voice, or go into processing a past trauma, or whatever work is needed. So here we just see the compassionate self, Stuart, bringing all these different elements together: mentality, motives, qualities, emotions. Essentially, what the compassionate self is doing, slightly different way of looking at it, is it's trying to bring some kind of order to an unintegrated, chaotic mind. So a lot of people have these emotions, you know, which have been classically conditioned to fire together, and it's all a bit chaotic. And then compassionate self has this role, really, of providing an inner secure base and safe haven, to start differentiating the different emotional states and to integrate them as well. So differentiation and integration, and compassionate self is really the kind of in the driving seat, trying to oversee this process. It's always a place, it's like a glue that holds the rest of the emotional parts together. And then finally, the intervention work. This is the how we direct the compassionate self. Now, this is where, once we've done the training, now we're ready and we're courageous enough, we've got all the skills to start going into processing the threat system. So this might be fears, phobias, traumas. It might be emotions that are not expressed, dissociated parts, avoided emotions. Compassionate self then becomes the place where we come from in trying to relate to these different experiences and emotions. And this is obviously an individual journey. You know, there's no sweeping rules about where to direct the compassion. It's going to be for the client to decide for themselves what feels safe, what feels helpful. And some of this, in Stuart's case, this was compassionate relating to his voices. And this is where we would draw on some of the voice dialogue techniques that have been developed, talking with voices. But it might be relating to compassion to parts of self, like self-critic or anxious self or sad self or angry self. The self, the part of me that fears I'll be rejected. Maybe that's where the compassion needs to be directed. The part of me that's been bullied. The 4-year-old version of me that's been sexually abused. Compassion then has the flexibility to go into all these areas where the work's needed. And this is just a nice diagram here that I often draw out with my clients about compassionate self is there in the middle. It's the place to come from when relating to these other parts, but it's also the place to come back to. When it gets distressing, or if it's feeling a bit overwhelming, then we just come back to the compassionate self. And in practical terms, we're usually in a therapy session, usually using chair work for this. So we have a compassionate self chair in the room, and a hostile voice who sits in another chair, and we get the client to move between the chairs to embody the different characters. Compassionate self is always a place where, when we come back there, we sit and we do some breathing and we start re-engaging physically, in the body sense, with with that compassionate self. We really take time over this. We're not rushing into these dialogues. We're really getting into the emotions of them. It's also helpful using imagery to set up these conversations between the compassionate self and other parts. And you can't see there on the bottom, it also says letter writing as well, which is another really, really helpful technique. So where the compassionate self will be writing a letter to the anxious self or to the critical voice, whoever needs to be listened to, really. So I want to just show a clip now of, it's just 2 minutes of Eleanor Longdon talking about her developing compassion to her voice, her voices, her critical voice. So if we could just play this now.
40 minutes is not enough time to fully credit those good and generous people who fought with me and for me and who waited to welcome me back from that agonized, lonely place. But together, they forged a blend of courage, creativity, integrity, and an unshakable belief that my shattered self could become healed and whole. I used to say that these people saved me, but what I now know is they did something even more important in that they empowered me to save myself. And crucially, they helped me to understand something which I'd always suspected, that my voices were a meaningful response to traumatic life events, particularly childhood events, and as such were not my enemies, but a source of insight into solvable emotional problems. Now, at first, this was very difficult to believe, not least because the voices appeared so hostile and menacing. So in this respect, a vital first step was learning to separate out a metaphorical meaning from what I'd previously interpreted to be a literal truth. So, for example, voices which threatened to attack my home, I learned to interpret as my own sense of fear and insecurity in the world rather than an actual objective danger. Now, at first, I would have believed them. I remember, for example, sitting up one night on guard outside my parents' room to protect them from what I thought was a genuine threat from the voices, because I'd had such a bad problem with self-injury that most of the cutlery in the house had been hidden. So I ended up arming myself with a plastic fork, like picnic ware, and sort of sat outside the room clutching it, waiting to spring into action should anything happen. It was like, don't mess with me. Got a plastic fork, don't you know? No, it's strategic. But a later response, and much more useful, would be to try and deconstruct the message behind the words. So when the voices warned me not to leave the house, then I would thank them for drawing my attention to how unsafe I felt, because if I was aware of it, then I could do something positive about it. But go on to reassure both them and myself that we were safe and didn't need to feel frightened anymore. I would set boundaries for the voices and try to interact with them in a way that was assertive yet respectful, establishing a slow process of communication and collaboration in which we could learn to work together and support one another. Throughout all of this, what I would ultimately realize was that each voice was closely related to aspects of myself, and that each of them carried overwhelming emotions that I'd never had an opportunity to process or resolve. Memories of sexual trauma and abuse, of anger, shame, guilt, low self-worth. The voices took the place of this pain and gave words to it. And possibly one of the greatest revelations was when I realized that the most hostile and aggressive voices actually represented the parts of me that had been hurt the most profoundly. And as such, it was these voices that needed to be shown the greatest compassion and care.
This is one of the really interesting and important things that Eleanor has pointed out there, is that the voices, you know, they might be very, very angry and hostile, but for her, and certainly for some of the clients I've been working with, you know, there's a point in therapy often where you can see that there might be a protective function going on here. And if we could start looking behind the voice at to what's driving the voice, you know, what's the emotion behind the voice? And certainly for Eleanor in this talk and in her personal experience, you know, there's actually part of her that's been really hurt, part of her that's been really threatened. So it must have taken her a hell of a lot of courage to start looking behind the hostility into the hurt. And I've had this experience a few times as a therapist where there's been a big shift in therapy when the client has developed that insight that actually then this voice might represent something that's quite hurt, quite vulnerable. Because at that point in therapy, that's when the compassion can really start to flow. You know, it's much, much easier being compassionate towards something that's suffering, something that's hurt. That is compassion. It's hard to be compassionate towards something that's angry and, you know, abusing you. And so for a lot of people, this is a big moment in therapy, that insight, thanks to Eleanor and but also, you know, how the work that Paul Gilbert's been doing with trying to understand the function of the self-critic, we can really start to understand the function of critical parts and voices. And very often they're protective, they're part of the threat system. So I'm just gonna play one more video, which is a very quick video looking at this really brings home this idea of seeing what's behind the sort of angry exterior. So I'll put that on now.
Do you want to just come through, take a seat? Do you want tea or coffee or anything?
I'm all right for the time being, thank you.
Okay. You look really well. What have you been up to?
Lots of rock climbing. Lots.
That sounds good. So, how's life these days?
Yeah, things are good. Got a job, got a girlfriend, got a little boy. I never let him go for what I went through. Still having the nightmares, though. But my anger's under control. I trust people more. I'm getting a bit better now. You know, it's like I can see a way out. That one from Bernardo's, all right? We talk a lot, and I trust her. Everyone else could just do one.
Woman from Bernardo's doesn't give up. Keeps asking why I nick stuff, do drugs, hit people. I told her where to go. Told my foster parents where to go. Just like the last ones. Don't trust no one. I ain't changing ever.
They laughed at me at the bus stop. Said I was thick. Won't say that again.
Mummy's boyfriend hits me. I tried hard, but he always finds me.
I'm scared.
Okay, so In that video, so we're really, it's almost like sort of peeling the layers of the onion, seeing what emotion is right at the core, what's right down there behind the layers of anger, maybe self-criticism, shame. You know, if we keep, and it's this kind of peeling away, trying to find what's under there driving these experiences. So this is what we'd be trying to do in a therapy session, in compassion focused therapy. We would be trying to, first of all, embody, you know, get into the chair of the compassionate self. So really, you know, connect with that, sense of calmness, safeness, wisdom, strength, and real desire for caring, and really real motivation for understanding distress and to alleviating distress. So we spend a lot of time practicing that. And then we would bring the voice. Obviously, this would all have to be you know, planned out with the client and planned by them, who they want, which voice they want to talk to. If any, And we would start asking the compassionate self to notice what are the emotions of the voice. You know, what emotions are the voice directing towards you? And, you know, the compassionate self can just, you know, imagine noticing this anger or disappointment being directed by the voice. And then, crucially, we start looking behind it. So, what is your voice, compassionate self? What is your voice really frightened of? So, we would be doing this in session really slowly, just sitting, imagining as their compassionate self, really trying to engage with kindness towards their voice and what might be behind the voice. So, what is your voice really frightened of? And seeing if we can hold the critical voice with kindness. Just imagining that for a minute, you know, just holding that voice with kindness. Recognizing that it comes from being threatened or hurt in the past, and seeing if the compassionate self, and can the compassionate self really try and connect with that fear that lies behind there. So, I mean, this is, you know, this is obviously some work that could take a long time to get to. And if it gets overwhelming, you know, because a lot of stuff will be coming up, you know, a lot of threat stuff will be coming up, trauma. So, of course, it's all got to be gradually done and carefully done and keep coming back to the compassionate self chair. If it gets too overwhelming, then we just come back here and do some breathing, focusing on the body posture, the strength. You know, maybe be just grounding again. And then when we feel a bit more safe, come back to the voice and some of the fear there. So, you know, very careful, slow kind of work, really emotional, really tuning in with the emotions that are going on here. I mean, there's not really enough time to talk in detail about interventions. And, you know, I hope that gives you a sense of what a therapy session might look like. So the therapist will be, you know, asking the client to move between chairs, really trying to connect with the feelings, and particularly the feelings that might be driving this voice. And of course, as part of the compassion approach, we'll be working with our compassion towards others, to, you know, people in our relationships, other people in the world, and also building the capacity to receive compassion. So there's always those three flows of compassion: self to other, other to self, self to self, and of course, self to voices. So I just wanted to share a little bit of feedback quickly about the video that we've had from people who hear voices. So it's had a load of YouTube views. Lots of people have kindly volunteered to translate it into different languages on YouTube. A lot of people have also provided some feedback from a survey. And I just want to focus on the people who hear voices who have given feedback. It's all anonymous feedback, and I don't know who they are. It was just online, so anyone who's watched it on YouTube could have given feedback. So these are some of the things. Usually the voices are mean and threatening, and I wonder why I deserve so much pain. This film has shown me that I'm basically a good person. You know, that's pretty good. That's pretty amazing to read that feedback. So and then there's some people who really kind of resonated with, actually it's very similar to their experiences. Obviously not everyone's going to have very different experiences, but a lot of people really connected with this person said exactly what goes on in my head. Thank you so much. It's encouraged me to continue practicing on accepting the voices. It's made me understand that I'm not the only one and that I can handle it. So that's just some of the feedback, if you kind of read through some of that. And then another page here as well. I watch it at least once per week. So I really, you know, this it's on YouTube. I really kind of encourage you to share the film and set up conversations around it, because there's something so powerful about animation and visual colors and sounds that's so much more effective at getting messages, emotional messages across. That you can, you know, that you can't really do in an hour and a half webinar or in an academic paper or in any kind of talk. So, you know, I really, you know, I use this animation in all of my therapy work and in my training for clinicians as well. So the final bit, really, we've got to come to an end. I'm doing a research study at King's College London. I'm trying to get some evidence for this approach. It's very, very early days, but some people have completed the therapy. I can't give you any data on that because we're still collecting data, but they've really engaged and really helped us evolve the therapy. All the clients who have been taking part as therapy clients have also been collaborators in developing the research, the therapy protocol, I should say. So there's a lot of wonderful people who hear voices who have been contributing to this and volunteering to be, you know, therapy candidates, and it seems to be going well so far. There's a few workshops. Some of you wanted to know about Ottawa, Vancouver. There's a few of that going on next year, but Ron can give you more information as and when. And there's a supervision group also on, if you go on the website, Compassion for Voices. If you do want to start doing some of this work, we found that people are quite worried, you know, about doing this work within the context of the traditional mental health services and colleagues who might not agree with it. So we've set up this supervision group to try and give people support and guidance about some of the things that are coming up as we've started to do this sort of these compassionate approaches to voices. So that's everything. I'm sorry you haven't left much time, but I can stay around a little bit more. I've got rid of my wife and kids, given them some money to go out for pizza. So if they come back, I might have to stop, but I can take some questions for anyone who wants to ask anything.
I noticed one question is whether it's okay for me to send out the PowerPoint to people in addition to the recording. Is that going to be it?
Yeah. If I give it to you in a PDF format, that would be fine. So you can have all the slides as a PDF.
All right. So yeah, just go ahead and type in questions. I see one from Eric. If you can turn the voices off and on at will, is it still a psychosis?
I think everyone is on a continuum with that. I was working with someone today who for about 2 months managed to turn her voices off at will. And then a couple of months later, you know, something became quite distressing with her benefits and welfare. And suddenly she lost that ability to control the voices. I don't think there are hard and fast answers. I mean, I prefer talking about the experience of voices and not really necessarily talking about fitting that into a label or a category, just purely talking about the experience themselves and developing relationships with them. And are there any, so Eric T. Lane, is there any, is that okay? Or is there anything else you, around that point that you were wanting me to clarify?
Yeah, well,
or any new questions?
While they're typing, I'll just mention something in the hearing voice. I like really like the hearing voices movement approach, that it's not the voices themselves that make it a problem that needs help. It's having trouble with the voices. It's not, and then often the trouble with the voices, if you look at it, it's really a trouble with the underlying emotions, but the voices make it kind of confusing to deal with them. But I think your method is great for helping kind of zone in on what those actual emotional problems are, and then helping the person work with them in a compassionate way.
Yeah. Absolutely. So what they can learn how to turn. I mean, it's a bit like asking, can you turn your thoughts on and off, or can you turn your feelings on and off? I mean, it's kind of, for me, that's, if someone came to therapy saying, I want to turn my voices off, you know, I would quite struggle to see how that would be a workable therapeutic goal. We'd try and sort of shift the focus more to the relationship with the voices and developing an understanding of the voices. But I could totally understand why people just want them to go away. I mean, it's, yeah, absolutely draining, devastating for a lot of people.
Sorry, I kind of interrupted.
Okay.
So Maria's asking if there's a citation or paper that she could read about how the threat system leads to jumping to conclusions.
I mean, jumping to conclusions, I mean, I don't have anything offhand, I'm afraid, but jumping to conclusions is probably the most found cognitive process that's associated with psychosis. And, you know, I don't think the literature has necessarily pinned down the mechanism of threat system in that. I think that's for future research. But certainly what we have is a lot of evidence for people operating their threat system jumping to conclusions, and people with psychosis jumping to conclusions. So we just need people to really marry the literature together. Okay. On that. So sorry, I don't have a paper that I can send you that nails everything.
Okay, I know it's Andrea's asking, do you offer some kind of training to work with?
Do you offer
approach?
Some kind of training? So, I'm doing quite a lot of training with Eleanor Longden internationally now. Like, we were actually over there in America 2 months ago in September, in Chicago and San Francisco. We're trying to get the approach out as much as possible. At the moment, there seems to be a lot of interest. So if you check on my website, Balanced Minds, or the Compassion for Voices website, I'm going to put up my 2017 workshops on there quite soon. They're not up there yet, but if you check in with that.
So Pat's asking that all voice hearers.
Not all voice hearers have any trauma.
Yeah. In their childhoods. Is there another way to conceptualize?
Yeah, I'm glad you raised that, Pat. Yeah, that's a really, really good point. So I totally agree. It's not trauma. I think it's misleading to think that we're talking about trauma in all cases. We're talking about threat, you know, so it's the red system. So trauma is one obviously extreme version of high threat, but the threat system can be active in in less, you know, it depends on your definition of trauma, I suppose. But yeah, threat experiences that have, you know, are, as I described in the webinar, you know, this is how we are modeling psychosis, and trauma would be one version of that, which basically leads the brain to use its threat protection mechanisms. So it doesn't have to be a trauma in the definition that you might be thinking of. We can think more generally about adversity and threats and bullying and situations of impasse or incompatibility, which might also require a brain to draw on its threat protection dissociative resources.
Looks like Andy's wondering if you know any psychologists.
I live in Miami. I don't in Florida, I'm afraid. So, I mean, I don't know who the best person to ask. I mean, Ron, do you have any ideas? Because you're probably more networked up than me with the.
Yeah, I don't know anybody specifically with compassion focused approach in Florida, unfortunately. Kate's wondering about suggested reading.
I know that you're still developing. So Andrew Gumley's paper, theoretical paper, which is 2010, is called, I did show a slide on it earlier briefly, A Compassion-Focused Model of Recovery After Psychosis, 2010, Gumley. Then Christine Brailer has done a study of group-based compassion-focused therapy for outpatients with psychosis. I'm just submitting another group of compassion-focused therapy. I've also just written a book chapter, which is in the final editing stages. So I might check what permissions I have to share that before I, you know, I don't think I can just share it straight away because it's just got to go through its final approval stages. But yeah, that kind of goes through all the stuff I've talked about today as a book chapter. Just trying to think. Oh yeah, and there's Sophie Mayhew, 2008, did a case series study of compassionate mind training in people who hear malevolent voices. So that's Mayhew, 2008. So there's just a few bits and bobs. Lots of people are looking at me to write more stuff. And I'm currently writing a lot with Eleanor at the moment. So if you give us a few months, there'll be a lot more because there's a big demand. So thanks for asking. Thanks, Greg. Thanks for that remark. Can you recommend any books? The Compassionate Mind Approach 2 series. Eleanor and I are actually doing the voice hearing book on self-help, self-compassion. Self-help book for voice hearing. It's the only one that's missing in the whole series. There's a compassionate mind approach to anger and anxiety and low self-esteem and all that. So the only thing that doesn't exist is the psychosis one. So we've started writing that. Skype therapy. In my experience, it's tricky. I think what I could, you know, what I would do, and that's if it was me as a therapist, I would offer to provide a sort of consultative role to a peer support group or something, you know, like the Hearing Voices Network. If some of you were meeting together and getting social support face to face, in that way, then I'd be happy to have occasional kind of, you know, sort of therapeutic consultative input, but you can't really replace, you know, this whole therapy is based on the power of social human connection, and Skype just doesn't quite do it. So a lot of people ask that in my, because I've got a private practice as well, and I kind of say that's okay, but as long as it's a one-off Skype meeting, that the bulk of the therapy has to be face-to-face or some kind of supportive social network, because we need to get the soothing affiliative system online, and that's much easier to do in person.
Cassie has a question.
Thank you for the...
Any suggestions for adopting this approach for more short-term settings, like an acute inpatient unit?
So there's a paper I forgot to mention before. It's actually my paper, Harriet Maitland et al. 2014, and it's called Compassion Focus Groups on Acute Inpatient Units. And it's a four session group. It's quite hard to adapt it to that environment, because there's a quick turnaround of clients and a lot of other stuff going on, appointments, but it was helpful, and the group ran and ran and ran. It kept running. So that was a really good it was a couple of years ago when I did that. I'm not running those groups anymore. But yeah, that paper's published in the British Journal of Clinical Psychology. So would you suggest anyone who would entertain ideas on how the brain operates based on learning? I'm not quite sure I understand that question. I might have to pass on that, Eric. I'm sorry. Do you have any ideas, Ron?
No, I think I'm in the same boat as you.
Okay, so sorry about that, Eric. Do you want to if you could rephrase the question a bit, just we'll clarify, that'd be great. And in the meantime, I'll have a look down the list. So support
Matthew
for groups.
Asking, yeah, where's a good place to get support for groups? I run a group for hearing voices and have trouble getting a reply from the hearing voices movement. I could mention one thing. I'll try to put this out when I send out a copy of the recording. There is a listserv for the hearing voices facilitators, and if you get on that, I'm pretty sure somebody on that list will respond if you have a question or comment. So I'll try to send out that information.
Right, thank you. I don't really know much about neuro-linguistic programming. Can't really comment, but yeah, Greg, that would be great. So you can see my email address there on the screen still. So please do email me for any more in-depth, conversations, or if you want to send me some stuff, or you want me to send you some stuff, then absolutely very welcome. I would really love, hell, in the spirit of compassionate approach. Oh, my computer's turned off. I think us sort of sharing ideas and helping each other out, is really sort of setting the tone for how we want to take this forward. So please do email me and continue these discussions and think about ways to take this forward, whether it's with groups or other Skypes or, I'd love to hear your ideas. Cool. So I think I've got through the questions for now. Oh, well, there might be a couple more coming.
Yeah, thanks everybody for the positive feedback. Glad you appreciated it. And I really appreciate you, Charlie, for showing up and presenting the work you're doing, which is really important.
Oh, thank you. Well, thank you for the opportunity.
There's another question. Something about art. Is it when voices attack you, the therapist? You had that sense when the voices become hostile towards you as the therapist?
Yeah, well, I think that's a really important part of therapy. I've got that happening right now with one of my clients. And so, you know, this to me is an important part of the process for this particular person, because this lady who I'm working with, she's idealized me so far in the therapy, which is in quite a kind of unhealthy way, in quite a sort of fantasy way. So actually, she's beginning to, and her voices are beginning to connect with some anger. And I think a lot of this is the realization that I'm not a perfect therapist, that I'm not a perfect ideal human being. So I think there's a very, very important process going here on here in the therapy. And the goal for us is to hold these multiple parts together, you know, and so they can coexist. On the one hand, we want an ideal therapist, but on the other hand, they're flawed. So we've been exploring this and trying to figure out how both and can exist at the same time. So like, you know, like anything, I think there's, you know, any therapy disruption or challenge, trying to sort of incorporate that and do multiple selves work, trying to explore that and integrate that. So I wouldn't get scared of that. I think it can happen a lot, and I might even ask for that early on. You know, I might even ask the voices how they feel about me talking to them like this, and I might ask the voices early on what they feel about us doing this work together in therapy. You know, because I think these emotions are very, very important and valid.
Okay. Notice.
Ideas about getting MDTs on board. So in the UK, I'm doing quite a lot of team training now, which is great, which is a new development. I think, you know, it used to be just for psychologists, but now teams want to get on board and arrange a like an away day for the MDT. So I think the model, I've stopped, my face has stopped moving in the video, but it doesn't matter. I think the model, because it's a model of the human brain, and there are some very fundamental, straightforward implications for just creating safeness. I mean, it is hard. It's not just creating safeness, but you know, there are implications for every team member. Every team member will know what their role is with this model, because it's not sophisticated, fancy, technical stuff. It's actually the human just slowing down, using facial expression, voice tone, and actually genuinely developing compassionate intent in that room. And I think once the team feel that they can be empowered just as much as therapists to use this approach, to draw on this model, that's a real boost for this kind of work.
I think you have gotten through the questions. I've stopped, mate.
Okay, cool. Thanks, Ron.
Well, great. Just really appreciate it, and looking, you know, and actually, like, as far as getting people on board with, the more we have resources out there, including this webinar, which is going to be made available, People can show that to somebody that doesn't understand the approach, and maybe they'll understand at least somewhat about it and understand why we're doing it. But I know it's kind of an uphill climb, but it's one worth doing. Anyway, thanks a lot.
All right. Thanks a lot then, guys. Have a good Friday. I'm off for the weekend.